Thank you. Now entering the quadrangle, students from the 50th reunion class. Now entering, students from the School of Medicine. Now entering the quadrangle, students from the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences. Now entering, students from Arts and Sciences. Now entering, students from the School of Social Work. Now entering, students from the School of Law. Now entering students from University College. Now entering students from the College of Arts and Sciences. Now entering students from the School of Architecture. Now entering students in the School of Art. Now entering students in the Graduate School of Business. Thank you. about to turn the corner and come in. Now entering students in the School of Engineering. Thank you. Welcome. Welcome to Washington University's 150th commencement exercises. I am Robert E. Wiltenberg, the Grand Marshal for this year's ceremony, which will begin with the singing of America the Beautiful by Caitlin M. Van Buren, who will receive her degree of Master of Music from the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences today. Will you please rise? Thank you, Caitlin. Will you please be seated? I now present the Chancellor of Washington University, Dr. Mark S. Wrighton.
Thank you, Dr. Wildenberg. Good morning, everyone. It's a privilege to welcome you to the graduation exercises for Washington University's class of 2011. I extend a special welcome to the 2,719 graduates because this is the day we recognize and celebrate the completion of your degree requirements. For you, your families, and your friends, this is a day to celebrate your extraordinary achievements leading to your graduation. It is also a great pleasure and honor to welcome and recognize members of the class of 1961 who have returned to the university to celebrate their 50th reunion. We value the association of these reuniting members of the class of 1961, we take pride in their lifetimes of accomplishment. Like alumni who have preceded them and those who have followed, you have made important contributions that are making the world a better place for all. Today, we also extend special recognition to individuals who will receive honorary degrees. Honorary degrees at Washington University are conferred by unanimous vote of the Board of Trustees, many of whom are on the stage before you. We recognize today five individuals for contributions they have made to their professions, to our community, and to society. Two of our very talented community members are making important contributions to the ceremony today. First, the singing of America the Beautiful was performed by Caitlin M. Van Buren, as you've heard, will receive her Master of Music degree from Arts and Sciences. Second, as we conclude our ceremony, we will sing the alma mater, led by Mr. William Taylor Martin. He will lead us as we conclude this ceremony. Mr. Martin is receiving his Bachelor of Arts degree from Arts and Sciences. Let's thank them both for their outstanding contribution. You've already heard the magnificent Mighty Mississippi Concert Band of St. Louis under the direction of Mr. Dan Presgrave, a member of the Faculty of Music in Arts and Sciences. Let's give them a round of applause as well. Thank you. As Dr. Wildenberg noted, you are participating in our 150th commencement ceremony. This great tradition began in 1862, and at that time, every graduate was invited to make an address. We're not going to continue that tradition. There were only five graduates in 1862. But this milestone in history reminds us of the enduring strength of Washington University, our students, alumni, faculty, and staff. Each of our graduates will have received a small memento to celebrate this occasion. Founded in 1853, Washington University remains dedicated to our motto, Per Veritatem Vis, strength through truth. Our early focus, of course, was regional, but for more than 100 years, we have had international students earning degrees at Washington University. On this, our 150th commencement, we begin a new tradition by flying the flags of the home countries of our graduating students here in the quadrangle. Many of the challenges of the next 150 years are ones that we must address together as a global community, and we celebrate the achievements of all students graduating today. A continuing tradition is to name a distinguished emeritus or emerita faculty member to serve as honorary grand marshal of commencement. For this commencement, we are privileged to have Professor Emerita Barbara A. Geller serve as the honorary Grand Marshal. I'd like to ask Professor Geller to stand while I say a few things about her. Professor Geller has been with Washington University for more than 20 years as a member of the faculty in the Department of Psychiatry. Professor Geller earned her bachelor's degree from Barnard College at Columbia University and her medical degree from Albert Einstein College of Medicine. She came to Washington University following appointments at New York University's Bellevue Medical Center, the University of Rochester Medical Center, Wayne State University, and the University of South Carolina School of Medicine. Since her arrival to Washington University in 1991, Dr. Geller has been a leader in teaching and research, as well as being a highly regarded clinician. Her expertise is in the area of childhood bipolar disorders, where she has received international recognition for her research contributions. Dr. Geller is one of the world's foremost experts on the use of medication and psychotherapy to manage childhood mood disorders. Her work has improved the quality of life for countless children and their families. Dr. Geller has received much recognition for her work, including the Nathan Cummings Special Research Award from the American Academy of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry, and the Exemplary Psychiatrist Award from the National Alliance for the Mentally Ill. Please join me in thanking Professor Geller for her many contributions to our field and Washington University. Aren't we so fortunate to have a powerful Department of Earth and Planetary Sciences that we can enjoy such good weather? Our ceremony today is, in fact, the academic highlight of our year. These proceedings continue a long tradition with origins dating back to the Middle Ages. I'm grateful to our Grand Marshal, Dr. Robert E. Wiltenberg, for the vital leadership role he plays in this wonderful tradition. The university advances because many of our most distinguished academic leaders are making contributions to the scholarly mission as well as to campus life. Thank you, Dean Wiltenberg, for your commitment to Washington University. It is now my pleasure to introduce the chairman of the Board of Trustees, Mr. Stephen F. Brower. Mr. Brower is a long-serving member of the board and assumed the position of chairman on July 1st, 2009. Mr. Brower is chairman of Hunter Engineering. We are grateful for the commitment that he and his wife Camilla have made to Washington University. Our newest building on the Danforth campus is named in their honor, Stephen F. and Camilla T. Brower Hall for the Departments of Biomedical Engineering and the Department of Energy, Environmental, and Chemical Engineering. Mr. Brower is an individual with a keen interest in history, dedicated to his family and community, and an unqualified success in his profession. Please welcome the chairman of our board, Mr. Stephen F. Brower.
Thank you, Mark, and good morning, and what a wonderful morning it is. As chairman of the Board of Trustees of Washington University, it's my privilege and pleasure to recognize the class of 2011 for your achievements, the 150th class to receive degrees since our first commencement ceremony in 1862. Today, you're graduating from one of the greatest universities in the world. You have succeeded in meeting rigorous academic challenges, and you have good reason to be proud. On behalf of the Board of Trustees, I congratulate you on a job well done. As members of the Washington University community, we share a mission to help make the world a better place than we found it. Today, we welcome members of the class of 1961 who are seated on stage today in honor of their 50 years of outstanding achievement. We expect to be equally proud of the class of 2011 when you sit here 50 years from now. In the meantime, we hope to see you back on campus from time to time. Have a safe and satisfying journey, and always remember this moment with great pride. My fellow trustees and I applaud you, your families, and everyone who is celebrating with you today. Our heartiest congratulations and best wishes for all your future endeavors. Thank you.
It is now my great privilege to introduce our commencement speaker, Elie Wiesel. Mr. Wiesel is among the world's most renowned writers and human rights activists, and we're honored to have him join us today at our historic 150th commencement. Elie Wiesel was born in 1928 in a small town in Transylvania, a region that is now a part of Romania. His early academic upbringing exposed him to both the classical and modern Hebrew language, and he spent his young life intensely focused on his religious studies. In 1944, when he was 15 years old, the Nazis deported Elie and his family to Auschwitz. He was separated from his mother and younger sister, who perished at the camp. Elie and his father were transported to Buchenwald, where his father died just before the camp was liberated in 1945. Following the war, Mr. Wiesel, still a teenager, sought asylum in France. Here he learned the French language and studied philosophy at the Sorbonne. He became a professional journalist writing for newspapers in Israel and France. For 10 years, Elie Wiesel was silent about his time in the Nazi concentration camps. In 1955, Catholic writer François Mauriac encouraged Elie to write about what he had experienced, a book with an English translation of, quote, "And the World Kept Silent," end quote. This work was later condensed into Wiesel's internationally acclaimed memoir, Night, which has been translated into more than 30 languages and has sold millions of copies since 1958. During the 1950s, Elie moved to New York City, and he was granted American citizenship. He continued his writings and is today the author of more than 50 books, including his most recent book, The Sonderberg Case, published just last year. Elie Wiesel was appointed in 1978 by then President Jimmy Carter as chairman of the President's Commission on the Holocaust. 2 years later, he became the president of the United States Holocaust Memorial Council, an organization that developed the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum in Washington, D.C. Elie Wiesel has been a steadfast defender of Israel, but he has also been outspoken in his support of Soviet Jews, Cambodian refugees, the Kurds, and victims of genocide in Africa, of apartheid in South Africa, and the war in the former Yugoslavia. Elie Wiesel has also been a devoted teacher, and since 1976, he has served as the Andrew W. Mellon Professor in the Humanities at Boston University, where he is a member of the faculty in the departments of religion and philosophy. For his dedication in speaking out about racism, violence, and oppression, Elie Wiesel was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 1986. He has also received the U.S. Congressional Gold Medal, the Presidential Medal of Freedom, and the National Humanities Medal. His talk this morning is titled Memory and Ethics. Graduates, families, and distinguished guests, I'm honored to introduce to you Professor Elie Wiesel.
Chancellor, Chairman of the Board of Trustees, members of the distinguished faculty, families, parents, grandparents, and friends, and especially, of course, the graduating class. I congratulate you, together with my other fellow recipients of the honorary degree. What you have learned here should not stay only in memory, but you must open the gates of your own memory and try to do something with what you have learned. I speak to you, of course, not only as a teacher, but also as a witness. And therefore, I must maybe define myself. You should know that I am Jewish. Maybe you don't know it. But to me, to be Jewish is what? It's not exclusive. It's an opening. It is really as when the conductor here conducts his orchestra. He offers the person to sing or to play a certain part, a certain tune. And I offer my memory to you. You should know something about what is there inside. But when I say that the Jew, the more Jewish he or she is, and the more universal is the message, I say that anyone else could say the same thing, whether as Protestant, Unitarian, Catholic, Buddhist, or even agnostic. We must be before we give. We must shield and protect the identity, the inner identity that we have and that makes us who we are. Now, the topic is memory. In the Bible, the expression is remember, don't forget. And when you study the text, you realize there is something wrong there. It's enough to say remember, or it's enough to say don't forget. Why the repetition? It could mean remember not to forget. It can also mean don't forget to remember. I say that knowing one thing, that this is a very, very great university. I have been here before you were born, most of you. I have been here some 35 years ago or so. And so humbly I realize that it took the leaders of this university 35 years to invite me again. Now, a story. A man is lost in the forest. And he tries to find the exit and cannot. It takes him hours, a night, a day, and he's still lost in the forest. On the third day, he notices that someone else is in the forest. He runs to him and he says, "Ah, I'm so glad to meet you. Please show me the way out." And he said, "I am like you, I am lost in the forest. One thing I can tell you, you see that road there, don't go there. I just come from there." I belong to a generation that tells you that. When you now will start your life, and you will of course enter a lot of roads, a lot of cities, maybe new universities, remember, there is something that you must remember. Don't go where I come from. The 20th century was one of the worst centuries in the history of humankind. Why? Because it was dominated by two fanaticisms. Political fanaticism, capital Moscow. Racist fanaticism, capital Berlin. And therefore, it has caused, that century has caused more deaths than any time before. What do we know now? A new threat is hanging upon us, and the name is fanaticism. We must do whatever we can to, first of all, unmask, second, to denounce, and of course, to oppose fanaticism wherever it is. What is fanaticism? Perversion. You can take a beautiful idea, like religion in the Middle Ages, but fanaticism can turn it into something which is anti-human, because a group of human beings decide that they know who is worthy of life, who is worthy of redemption. And today, fanaticism has reached even a lower point in its development. The fanatic who becomes a suicide murderer. That is a kind of atom bomb. The suicide murderer who becomes himself, in some cases herself, a weapon. They do not want simply to die. For that they could simply jump into the ocean or under a bus. They want to kill innocent people mainly, including children. And therefore, that is an option that you must resist in your own life. What else have we learned? That we are not alone in this world. God alone is alone. Human beings are not. We are here to be together with others, and I insist on the others. Which means, in some places, in some groups, they are suspicious of the other. Don't. I see the otherness of the other, which appeals to me. In fact, it is the otherness of the other that makes me who I am. I have always to learn from the other. And the other is to me not an enemy, but a companion, an ally. And of course, in some cases of grace, a friend. So the other is never to be rejected and surely not humiliated. What else? I quote the Bible, I continue because after all, that is my study, that's my upbringing. The greatest commandment to me in the Bible is not the Ten Commandments. First of all, it's too difficult to observe. Second, we all pretend to observe. My commandment is, thou shalt not stand idly by. Which means when you witness an injustice, don't stand idly by. When you hear of a person or a group being persecuted, do not stand idly by. When there is something wrong with the community around you or far away, do not stand idly by. You must intervene. You must interfere. And that is actually the motto of human rights. Human rights has become a kind of secular religion today. And I applaud it. I am part of it. And therefore, wherever something happens, I try to be there as a witness. My last dramatic visits was to Bosnia. I was sent by President Clinton as a presidential envoy. And I would go there really, in those places in Bosnia, I would go speaking to the victims. My interest is the victims. And I would go literally from person to person, from family to family, from barrack to barrack, from tent to tent, asking them to tell me their stories. And they always began and they stopped in the middle. Not one of the people I interviewed or interrogated ended the story. And the story usually was about rape in the family, about murder, about torture, about humiliation. No one finished the story, because they all burst into tears. And then I realized maybe that is my mission as a teacher, as a witness, to finish the story for them. Because they were crying and crying and crying. And I felt like in a Talmudic source, Prophet Elijah was sent down to our planet to do. I said, I'm going to collect their tears and turn them into stories. Now, you have already known something which I didn't know before I came here. This university is not only great because of its great faculty and its marvelous students, but also because it has a tradition. The commencement speaker should speak only for 15 minutes. I'm sure they meant well because they felt sorry for you, graduates. You are waiting impatiently for the moment when the chancellor will come and offer you the degree. So why should I expose you to torture, the torture of waiting? I want you to know, with all that I have gone through in life, I still have faith in humanity. I still have faith in the humanity of people. I have faith in language, although language was perverted by the enemy. I have faith in God, although I quarrel with him a lot of time. I don't know whether he feels upset or not, but I do. Why? Because I don't want to break the chain that links me to my parents and grandparents and theirs and theirs and theirs. And furthermore, I believe that a human being is any human being of any community, any origin, any color. A human being is eternal. Any human being is a challenge. Any human being is worthy of my attention, of my love occasionally. And therefore, I say it to you, when you are now going into a world which is haunted, obsessed with so much violence, often so much despair, when you enter this world and you say the world is not good today, good, correct it. That's why you have learned here for 4 years from your great teachers. Go there and tell them what you remember. Tell them that the nobility of the human being cannot be denied to anyone. I'm sure you have learned French literature. I'm sure you have learned Camus, Albert Camus, the great philosopher and novelist. In his famous novel, The Plague, at the end, Dr. Rieu, who was the character, the main character of the novel, and he sees a devastated city. Thousands and thousands were victims of the plague. And this doctor, at the end, says it's true. All that is true. But nevertheless, I believe, he said, there is more in any human being to celebrate than to denigrate. I repeat, there is more in any human being to celebrate than to denigrate. Let's celebrate. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Wiesel, for that inspiring message. Chancellor Wrighton will now confer the honorary degrees. You will find biographical information on each honorary degree recipient in your commencement program.
I have asked members of the Board of Trustees to assist me today in conferring the honorary degrees. I'd like to call forward Trustee David W. Kemper, who will present John H. Biggs.
Chancellor Wrighton, I have the privilege of presenting John Heron Biggs, former Chief Executive Officer of TIA-CREF, the nation's largest pension fund, former Vice Chancellor for Administration and Finance at Washington University, and Emeritus Trustee. During his 13 years at TIA-CREF, Dr. Biggs led the organization in defining a credible, responsible, active intervention in improving corporate governance of United States public companies. His work helped Congress formulate the auditing provisions of the Sarbanes-Oxley Act, which strengthened the Securities and Exchange Commission's authority with respect to accounting firms. At Washington University, he created a tuition stabilization plan that was the first of its kind and widely copied by other colleges and universities. Dr. Biggs, you have influenced major changes in the oversight and regulatory structure of the auditing profession. You are a tireless advocate for protecting the retirement resources of individuals, particularly those in higher education. We at Washington University are proud to recognize your accomplishments by bestowing upon you the honorary degree of Doctor of Humane Letters.
I'd like to call forward Trustee George P. Bauer, who will present Shirley Ann Jackson.
Chancellor Wrighton, I have the privilege of presenting the Honorable Shirley Ann Jackson, President of Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, a member of the President's Council of Advisors on Science and Technology, and former chair of the U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission. Time magazine has described Dr. Jackson as the ultimate role model for women in science. As the grandfather of three granddaughters, Doctor, I appreciate that honor. She has held senior leadership positions in government, industry, research, and academia. Her leadership of Rensselaer Polytech Institute has led to innovations in the curriculum, increased scholarships, new faculty, and an increase in research awards. She spearheaded the formation of the International Nuclear Regulators Association, served as its first chairman, and guided its development as a high-level forum to examine issues and offer assistance to other nations on matters of nuclear safety. Dr. Jackson, you have made significant contributions to science and technology, to public policy, and you inspire others to pursue careers in engineering and science. We at Washington University are proud to recognize your accomplishments by bestowing upon you the honorary degree of Doctor of Science.
Chancellor Emeritus and Trustee William H. Danforth will present George W. von Mallinckrodt.
Chancellor Wrighton, I'm honored to present an admired and respected friend and international banker, George W. Mallinckrodt, KBE. KBE means that Queen Elizabeth II appointed him Knight Commander of the British Empire. In 1954, he joined the New York office of Schroders, a large international bank and asset management company founded 200 years ago, headquartered in London. He soon became a leader, playing a key role in transforming the company to meet the ever-changing needs of the world. He served as executive chairman for 11 years and as president, always combining character and ability as one would want an ideal banker to do. German-born with local relatives, George Mallinckrodt has been long interested in St. Louis, Missouri, and in Washington University. His interests are wide-ranging, including planning for the Davos conferences, for the British Museum, the environment, and the role of religion in the modern world. George Mallinckrodt, you make our world better. Washington University is proud to recognize your contributions with the honorary degree of Doctor of Laws.
Trustee Arnold W. Donald will present Griffin P. Rogers.
Good morning, Chancellor Wrighton, Our next honoree and I have been lifelong friends since the eighth grade and our high school days in New Orleans. And while that most certainly is not one of his many claims to fame, it does give me a very special and distinct privilege to present Dr. Griffin P. Rogers, Director of the National Institute of Diabetes and Digestive and Kidney Diseases of the National Institutes of Health. He also is the proud parent of Christopher, a graduating senior in the Olin Business School, and like his father, an avid New Orleans Saints fan. Dr. Rogers is nationally and internationally recognized for his contributions to the development of effective therapy for sickle cell anemia and other genetic diseases of hemoglobin. He has received numerous awards for this research, including the Scroll of Merit Award from the National Medical Association, the Arthur S. Fleming Award, and the Richard and Hinda Rosenthal Foundation Award, among many, many others. Dr. Rogers, Griffin, your career at the National Institutes of Health has been notable for your research achievements that directly affect the health of thousands of Americans and millions of people throughout the world. We at Washington University are very proud to recognize your accomplishments by bestowing upon you the honorary degree of Doctor of Science.
Trustee Maxine Clark will present Elie Wiesel.
Good morning, Chancellor Wrighton. I have the privilege of presenting Professor Elie Wiesel, author, teacher, defender of human rights, and messenger to mankind. Professor Wiesel was 15 years old when he and his family were deported to Auschwitz. Persuaded to write about his experiences in the death camps, the result was his internationally acclaimed memoir, Night, which has been translated into more than 30 languages. He's a prolific author, counting more than 50 books of fiction and nonfiction to his name. He has a passion for teaching and is the Andrew W. Mellon Professor of the Humanities at Boston University. Professor Wiesel has used his personal experience of the Holocaust to work on behalf of oppressed people around the globe for much of his adult life. In recognition of his efforts, he was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 1986. Professor Wiesel, we at Washington University are proud to recognize and to celebrate your commitment to peace, atonement, and human dignity by bestowing upon you the honorary degree of Doctor of Humane Letters.
Will all the members of the Board of Trustees please rise? Will all the honorary degree recipients please rise? By virtue of the authority delegated to me on behalf of Washington University, I hereby confer upon each of you the appropriate honorary degree and declare that your names shall forever be inscribed upon the enduring roll of the university's honorary sons and daughters. Congratulations. You may be seated.
I wish to introduce the president of the senior class, Keith Alexander Kiles.
I remember 4 years ago, it was freshman convocation. Wow, that seems like forever ago. I remember being so excited about college and chanting emphatically, Ruby Umrath, where are you at? Can I get a hand clap? I see you guys. I remember booing Wayman Crow as if my life depended on it. But in the back of my mind, having no idea who or what a Wayman Crow was or why they were my rivals. But in the end, it didn't matter. What mattered was instantly feeling like you belonged to a family. I remember the entire gymnasium filled with vibrantly colored t-shirts and our parents beaming proudly from the stands above. I remember filing out of the athletic complex after the sun had set and nervously following the path to Brookings Quadrangle. Chancellor Wrighton, I'm not gonna lie, all of those glow sticks lining the path really freaked me out freshman year. Well, here we are today. We have come full circle. We are back in Brookings Quadrangle. And this time, instead of beginning our journey at Washington University, we are now preparing to say goodbye. But before everyone starts getting teary-eyed, let's look back at some of the highlights of our time here at WashU. Well, so since we have been here, Steve Jobs has announced the release of the iPhone. The seventh Harry Potter book and the seventh Harry Potter movie have swept the nation. Crank That Soldier Boy became a number one hit in the US for 7 straight weeks. And rumor has it that it will be Chancellor Wrighton's next music video. We have witnessed the birth of Twitter. I bet some of you are probably tweeting right now about how bored you are sitting there in the crowd, or about how awesome my speech is. We've seen Alberto Gonzalez, and we almost saw Bristol Palin. We've attended Wild semester after semester, hoping that just once we would have heard of the band prior to their arrival. We have seen Woo Slam sell out Edison Theater after only existing for 2 years on campus. We have seen Stephen Bailey, Megan DeVilliers, Christina Mosher, Michael Chen, and the Swix Committee plan the best senior week ever. We've spent late nights studying in whispers, getting coffee at the 75-cent coffee machine that is so much better than the $5 lattes around the corner. We've joyfully wallowed in the mud for Holy's massive water balloon fight. We've watched tornadoes show up every year for 13 Carnival. We've seen the school close for the first time in decades for the snowpocalypse. And we've raised hundreds of thousands of dollars for charity through Dance Marathon, Relay for Life, and Mr. WashU. Remember those late nights at Bear's Den? Remember trying that T-Rex for the first time on a dare? Parents, a T-Rex consists of fried chicken tenders, fried mozzarella sticks, cheese, toasted ravioli, all wrapped up inside a burrito, and deep fried. In other words, simply delicious. We have fond memories of staying up all night in studio or the CEC, or getting together 3 years later with our freshman floor just to play intramural badminton. But you see, that's what college is about. We've made some wonderful memories and created priceless bonds that will last for the rest of our lives. Yes, we have had some great times here at Washington University, but I want to stop reminiscing about the past and begin to look to the future. We spend our whole lives talking about what we want to do when we grow up. Well, here we are. We've grown up. Now is the time to do everything that we have ever wanted to do, accomplish all of the goals that we have set. What are we waiting for? It's time to step up and follow our passions. Look around the crowd today. We have biomedical engineering students working on projects that will revolutionize the world of medicine. There are medical students finding the cure for cancer. Business students starting the next corporation that will be bigger than Facebook. There are future senators, entrepreneurs, politicians, philosophers, world-renowned architects, and Nobel Prize winners. The amount of inspiration that is in this quad today is truly phenomenal. My friends, we are at a critical point in our lives right now. I admit it's terrifying at times. However, we are now presented with a choice. We can either succumb to our fears and remain stagnant in our routines, or we can grasp the reins of our destiny and channel our worries into intensity. I want to look back when I'm old, slightly senile, and sitting in a rocking chair on my front porch, and after yelling at the pesky neighborhood kids, I want to be able to sit back, smile contentedly, and say, life's been good. That starts now. We can make life good. The future may seem uncertain and frightening, but now is not the moment to be sad. Rather, we should feel empowered because now we have the chance to forge the future that we want. We are here today to dream, to create, to celebrate. Now is the time to boldly stare the world in the eye and declare, I am ready, bring it. As I look at everyone sitting in their caps and gowns, I cannot help but notice one thing. We are a generation that is unique. A generation this world has never seen before. A generation of bold ideas and ingenious innovations. A generation that is not afraid to step up and confront injustice. A generation that is defeating impossibility every single day. We are a generation that is optimistic and above all, determined, unimaginably determined. So, my fellow members of the class of 2011, I invite you to join me and we will confront the future together. You want to change the world? Now is the time to do it. The world is yours. This is our time and no one can take that away from us. Thank you.
Thank you, Alex. For the presentation of academic degrees, I now present the Provost and Executive Vice Chancellor of Washington University, Edward S. Macias.
For the presentation of academic degrees in Arts and Sciences, I now present the Dean of the Faculty of Arts and Sciences, Gary S. Will.
Thank you, Provost Macias. For the presentation of students in the College of Arts and Sciences, I wish to introduce the Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences, James E. McLeod.
Thank you. The student marshals for the degrees of Bachelor of Arts and Bachelor of Music in Arts and Sciences, and Bachelor of Science in Architecture will please come forward. Candidates for these degrees will please rise. Chancellor Wrighton, I have the honor to present these candidates for the degrees of Bachelor of Arts and Bachelor of Music in Arts and Sciences and Bachelor of Science in Architecture. They are duly recommended by the Faculty of Arts and Sciences. The candidates will please be seated. Thank you. Thank you.
For the presentation of students in University College, I wish to introduce the Associate Dean of University College, Rebecca L. Copeland.
Thank you, Dean Will. The student marshals for the degrees of Associate in Arts and Bachelor of Science will please come forward. Candidates for these degrees will please rise. Chancellor Wrighton, I have the honor of presenting these candidates for the degrees of Associate in Arts and Bachelor of Science, who are duly recommended by the Faculty of Arts and Sciences. Congratulations. The candidates will please be seated.
For the presentation of graduate students in Arts and Sciences, I wish to introduce the Dean of the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences, Richard J. Smith.
The student marshals for the master's degrees in the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences will please come forward. Candidates for the degrees will please rise. Chancellor Wrighton, I have the honor to present these candidates for the degrees of Master of Arts, Master of Arts in Education, Master of Arts in Teaching, Master of Fine Arts in Writing, Master of Liberal Arts, Master of Music, and Master of Science in Biology. They have been examined and are duly recommended by the faculty of the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences. The candidates may hood one another. The candidates will please be seated. The student marshals for the degree of Doctor of Philosophy will please come forward. Candidates for this degree will please rise. Chancellor Wrighton, it is with high honor that I present these outstanding candidates for the degree of Doctor of Philosophy. They have fulfilled the many requirements for this advanced degree and are approved by the faculty of the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences. The candidates may hood one another. The candidates will please be seated.
For the presentation of the School of Engineering, I wish to introduce the Dean of the School of Engineering and Applied Science, Ralph S. Quattrano.
The student marshals for the Bachelor of Science degrees will please come forward. Candidates for the degrees will please rise. Chancellor Wrighton, I have the honor to present these candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Science. They are duly recommended by the faculty of the School of Engineering and Applied Science. The candidates will please be seated. Student Marshal for the. The Student Marshal for the graduate degrees in the School of Engineering and Applied Science will please come forward. Candidates for the degrees will please rise. Chancellor Wrighton, I have the honor to present these candidates for the master's and doctoral degrees in engineering. They have been examined and are duly recommended by the faculty of the School of Engineering and Applied Science. The candidates may hood one another. Candidates will please be seated.
For the presentation of academic degrees in the Sam Fox School of Design and Visual Arts, I now present Dean Carmen Colangelo.
For the presentation of students in architecture, I wish to introduce the Dean of the College of Architecture and the Graduate School of Architecture and Urban Design in the Sam Fox School of Design and Visual Arts, Bruce M. Lindsay.
The Student Marshal for the degree of Bachelor of Technology in Architectural Technology will please come forward. Candidates for this degree will please rise. Chancellor Wrighton, I have the honor to present these candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Technology in Architectural Technology, who are duly recommended by the faculty of the College of Architecture. Congratulations. Thank you. The candidates will please be seated. I would now like to recognize the students who are receiving from the College of Arts and Sciences a Bachelor of Arts with a major in Architecture or a Bachelor of Science in Architecture. Will these students please stand and be recognized? The candidates will please be seated. The Student Marshals for the Master's Degrees in the Graduate School of Architecture and Urban Design will please come forward. Candidates for the degrees will please rise. Chancellor Wrighton, I have the honor to present these candidates for the degrees of Master of Architecture and Master of Urban Design. They have been examined and are duly recommended by the faculty of the Graduate School of Architecture and Urban Design. Candidates may hood one another. Congratulations. Thank you. The candidates will please be seated.
For the presentation of students in art, I wish to introduce the Dean of the College of Art and the Graduate School of Art in the Sam Fox School of Design and Visual Arts, Buzz Spector.
The student marshals for the degree of Bachelor of Fine Arts will please come forward. Candidates for this degree will please rise. Chancellor Wrighton, I have the honor to present these candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Fine Arts, who are duly recommended by the faculty of the College of Art. The candidates will please be seated. The student marshal for the degree of Master of Fine Arts will please come forward. Candidates for this degree will please rise. Chancellor Wrighton, I have the honor to present these candidates for the degree of Master of Fine Arts, who have been examined and are duly recommended by the faculty of the Graduate School of Art. The candidates may hood one another.
The candidates may be seated. For the presentation of students in the School of Business, I wish to introduce the Dean of the John M. Olin School of Business, Mahendra R. Gupta.
The student marshals for the degree of Bachelor of Science in Business Administration in John M. Olin School of Business will please come forward. Candidates for the degree will please rise. Chancellor Wrighton, I have the honor to present these candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Science in Business Administration. They are duly recommended by the faculty of the John M. Olin School of Business. The candidate will please be seated. The student marshals for the master's degrees in the John M. Olin School of Business will please come forward. Candidates for the degrees will please rise. Chancellor Wrighton, I have the honor to present these candidates for the degrees of Master of Business Administration, Master of Accounting, Master of Science in Business Administration, Master of Science in Finance, and Master of Science in Supply Chain Management. They have been examined and duly recommended by the faculty of the John M. Olin School of Business. The candidates may hood one another. The candidates will please be seated.
For the presentation of the students in the School of Social Work, I wish to introduce the Dean of the George Warren Brown School of Social Work, Edward F. Lawler.
The student marshals for the master's degrees in the George Warren Brown School of Social Work will please come forward. Candidates for the degrees will please rise. Chancellor Wrighton, I have the honor to present these candidates for the degrees of Master of Social Work and Master of Public Health, who have been examined and are duly recommended by the faculty of the George Warren Brown School of Social Work. The candidates may now hood one another. The candidates will please be seated.
For the presentation of the students in the School of Law, I wish to introduce the Dean of the School of Law, Kent D. Severud.
The student marshals for the master's and doctoral degrees in the Washington University School of Law will please come forward. The candidates for all law degrees will please rise. Chancellor Wrighton, I have the honor to present these candidates for the degrees of Doctor of Laws, Master of Laws, and Doctor of the Science Law, who have been examined and duly recommended by my colleagues on the faculty of the School of Law. The candidates may hood one another. The candidates will please be seated.
For the presentation of the students in the School of Medicine, I wish to introduce the Dean of the School of Medicine, Larry J. Shapiro.
The student marshal for the master's degrees in the School of Medicine will please come forward. The candidates for the degrees will please rise. Chancellor Wrighton, I have the honor to present these candidates for the degrees of Master of Psychiatric Epidemiology, Master of Science in Clinical Investigation, Master of Science in Deaf Education, Master of Science in Genetic Epidemiology, and Master of Science in Occupational Therapy. They have been examined and are duly recommended by the faculty of the School of Medicine. The candidates may hood one another. The candidates will please be seated. The student marshals for the doctoral degrees in the School of Medicine will please come forward. Candidates for the degrees will please rise. Chancellor Wrighton, I have the high honor to present these candidates who have fulfilled the many requirements for the degrees of Doctor of Medicine, Doctor of Audiology, Doctor of Occupational Therapy, and Doctor of Physical Therapy. They have been approved and are proudly recommended by the faculty of the School of Medicine. The candidates may hood one another. The candidates will please be seated.
Will all of the faculty please rise? Will all of the candidates who have completed the requirements for the bachelor's degree please rise? By virtue of the authority delegated to me on behalf of Washington University, I hereby confer upon each of you your bachelor's degree with all its attendant rights, privileges, and obligations. The graduates will please be seated. Will all the candidates who have completed the requirements for the master's degree please rise? By virtue of the authority delegated to me on behalf of Washington University, I hereby confer upon each of you your master's degree with all its attendant rights, privileges, and obligations. The graduates will please be seated. Will all of the candidates who have completed the requirements for the doctoral degree please rise? By virtue of the authority delegated to me on behalf of Washington University, I hereby confer upon each of you your doctoral degree with all its attendant rights, privileges, and obligations. Will the doctors please be seated? The faculty may be seated. Continuing a long tradition, I would like to note that today several of our graduates have participated in the Reserve Officers Training Program and have been commissioned second lieutenants in the United States Army or second lieutenants in the United States Air Force. Would they please stand and be recognized? Thank you. Congratulations to the entire class of 2011. You have accomplished an enormous amount, and you have even greater potential now than when you began your studies here. I am proud that you're now alumni of Washington University. You've earned a degree, but you've done more than grow intellectually. You've also matured emotionally and socially. Your newly acquired education will serve you well throughout your life, and the Washington University friendships and memories are ones I hope you return to often. You have been involved in very significant service activities, including Relay for Life, Dance Marathon, and Service First, and these have brought many benefits to our community. Some of you have been involved in programs through the campus-wide, religious or Greek organizations. In these and many other public service activities, our students have been creators and leaders in supporting our community. Many of our students recently stepped forward to assist our friends and colleagues in Japan in the aftermath of the terrible tsunami following the earthquake on March 11th. To the graduating seniors, thank you for Teach Me How to Donate, a catchy tune that stimulated more than 80% of the class to make a gift to support scholarships for future generations of students. To all students, thank you for leaving Washington University a stronger institution than you found it. We've had fun and excitement in athletics, with a large number of NCAA Division III teams succeeding at the very highest level. We've won NCAA championships in women's volleyball, men's and women's basketball, and men's tennis. Members of this class have performed and supported theater, music, and dance, and you've enhanced our cultural understanding through Black Anthology, Carnival, Diwali, the Powwow, and the Lunar New Year Festival. Many of you have been involved in research and other creative work that will enhance the quality of life in the future. I'm grateful for the opportunity to serve such talented students and to see your success here. You have worked hard and creatively, but you have not realized this success on your own. Graduates have been supported by parents and other family members, by friends, and by Washington University faculty, staff, and advisors. And many among you have been supported by generous donors who provided scholarship gifts to support our students. Graduates, would you join me in thanking all those who have assisted you? As I expect for our new alumni, our class of 1961 has certainly achieved a great deal in the 50 years since their graduation. We celebrate them and their achievements. Let's look back to 1961. The hit songs of that year included Moon River, Where the Boys Are, Blue Moon, and The Lion Sleeps Tonight. Joseph Heller's Catch-22 was published, and the movie version of West Side Story premiered. Our commencement speaker's book, Dawn, the second in the trilogy of Night, Dawn, and Day, was published in 1961. This trilogy describes Professor Wiesel's thoughts during and after the Holocaust. What a privilege it is to have Professor Wiesel with us today. Thank you once again. In an ominous development in 1961, East Germany built a wall separating East and West Berlin, a barrier that would not fall for nearly three decades. But like our commencement today, 1961 was a time of new beginnings and one during which idealism was rekindled. 1961 was the year that began the presidency of John F. Kennedy. In 1961, President Kennedy established the Peace Corps, a program that has attracted some of today's graduates. In 1961, he also launched the effort to put a person on the moon within 10 years. That goal was achieved on July 20th, 1969, with the mission of Apollo 11. Clearly, much has happened during the 50 years since 1961, including many positive advances, but with also new challenges. In 1961, there was no Amazon, Google, Facebook, Twitter, or iPhone. But in 1961, there was also little appreciation of the global challenges that would become evident now, 50 years later. Challenges related to growth in population and consumption of energy. To our new graduates, the world is facing an overwhelming challenge. How do we provide the energy the world needs at a price we can afford without additional adverse consequences to the environment? The scale of the challenge is gargantuan. Just to illustrate scale and cost, let's assume that all of the world's additional future energy needs were to be met with nuclear power. I'm not advocating this. Just let me illustrate the scale and cost to meet the world's future energy needs. It's projected that by 2050, we will move from needing about 15 terawatts of power today to 30 terawatts to power civilization 40 years from now. That's an additional 15 trillion watts of power within 40 years. What would this mean in terms of development of nuclear power? This would require the world to build 15,000 nuclear power plants, each with a 1 gigawatt generating capacity, and building one at a rate of one new plant every day for the next 40 years. Each plant would require approximately $10 billion of capital for a total of $150 trillion, even larger than the U.S. national debt. Even if we could do this to avoid the additional emission of carbon dioxide from expanded energy use, we would still have the 15 terawatts being generated today producing a great deal of threatening carbon dioxide, as much of our energy in the world now comes from fossil fuels. The growth in the world's population and the development of countries with large populations like India and China mean that we will need much more energy than we use today. The challenge is, again, how do we provide the energy we need at an affordable cost without additional adverse consequences to the environment? There is no simple answer to this question. Nuclear power had been thought to be a part of the solution, but that is now very uncertain following the disaster in Japan. I had the privilege of serving as vice chair of the National Research Council Committee on America's Energy Future, a group of academicians and industry leaders with expertise in science, technology, economics, and policy. Our committee report was issued about 2 years ago and called for a transformation of how we produce, distribute, and use energy to increase sustainability, support long-term economic prosperity, promote energy security, and reduce adverse environmental impact. But the United States will only represent a small part of the world with about 5% of the projected 9 billion people who will be living in 2050. Thus, we need to address energy and environmental challenges as a global community. I'm very proud that our own McDonnell International Scholars Academy, consisting of 28 research universities around the world, convened a conference here in St. Louis this academic year. The theme of the conference was a global energy future. By working collaboratively, I remain optimistic that we can creatively and effectively address what might be the world's greatest challenge. Many technologies will assist in meeting future energy needs, but there will be important policy, economic, and social issues to address. The large-scale development of solar energy seems most promising, because solar energy striking the Earth is equivalent to more than 100,000 terawatts. This inexhaustible source of energy must be tapped, but the technical hurdles are great, including the need for lower cost, higher efficiency, and ultimately storage of solar energy to be able to provide our energy needs at night. No research university or corporate entity, indeed, no country alone can solve the problems we face in relation to energy and environment. But by working together, we can make faster progress. Thus, it is fitting that we recognize the importance of international partnerships at this historic 150th commencement of Washington University. There are other daunting problems that accompany the much larger population of 2050, including needs for clean water, nutritious food, and improved health. Further, Today, about half the world's current population of 6 billion people live on less than $2 per day. How do we realize a future with greater economic prosperity for those 3 billion people? Progress is being made on these issues, but new problems are also emerging. For example, in developed countries, advances in medicine, nutrition, and public health have brought an additional challenge, an aging global population with a whole new set of health and social issues. Our university and its graduates will be a part of the solution to the world's greatest problems. I'm pleased that today we have the first graduates of our Master's of Public Health degree program. This has been an outgrowth of careful planning at the university that also led to the formation of our Institute for Public Health. This initiative involves all 7 schools of the university, but with special leadership from the Brown School with our first master's degree in public health and from our School of Medicine. From its planning activities, the Fox School of Design and Visual Arts recently established this region's only master's degree program in landscape architecture, a vital contribution to sustainable design. Engineers are educated here to advance the human condition through the application of technology. New technology and applications also hold the promise of new commercial enterprises that can lead to economic advances. We've had important practical outcomes from our research that have benefited people and also had major financial success. 2 new companies headquartered in St. Louis, Announced Media and Exegy, have been spawned by faculty, students, and alumni from the School of Engineering, the Olin School of Business, and Arts and Sciences. The network of faculty, students, and alumni from different schools of the university represent a powerful asset, and is my hope that our new alumni become actively engaged in our global network of more than 120,000 alumni. New commercial enterprises come to mind when one mentions research universities, innovation, and entrepreneurship in the same sentence. But the outcome from innovation and entrepreneurship is much more than companies. And a research university like ours prepares people in all areas to be innovators and entrepreneurs. In the university itself, new educational programs like those I've mentioned and teaching methods that are developed are the outcome from innovative and entrepreneurial faculty. We have a new minor in public health, in arts and sciences. And we have an outstanding collaborative scholarly program engaging our Department of Political Science and our School of Law. Surely, those in the arts are innovators in their field, as creative as they are. As 2011 graduates, you are prepared with the knowledge and critical thinking ability to be the innovators and entrepreneurs that are going to be needed to meet society's needs and fulfill your own dreams and aspirations. In my welcome address to new undergraduates 4 years ago, I quoted Louis Pasteur, who said that chance favors the prepared mind. I would like to underscore that point today. Your success in life will depend on being prepared and having a good plan. That plan may need to change as new opportunities and challenges arise. Many of our new alumni will go on to advanced educational experiences, some to employment, others to public service, and some are still defining the next step. Whatever your next step, you are well prepared. In 1961, President Kennedy announced the effort to put a man on the moon and to return him safely to Earth before the end of the 1960s. That effort required a great deal of preparation and planning. The liftoff of Apollo 11 on July 16, 1969, began a magnificent achievement that involved many in our society. Today, I see your potential for great achievement, and you're on the launch pad, fueled and ready to go. Ladies and gentlemen, start your engines. You're ready for liftoff. Congratulations.
Let us now stand and remove our caps for the singing of the alma mater. The words may be found in the back of the program. William Taylor Martin, who received the degree of Bachelor of Arts from the College of Arts and Sciences today, will lead us, and we invite everyone to please join in the singing of the Washington University alma mater. Following the alma mater, we ask that parents and guests remain in their seats until the end of the academic recession and all degree recipients have exited the quadrangle.
Country for all eternity.